Now, so good morning to everyone. Thank you very much to be with us on this Friday side cafe of the Hellenic Mediterranean University. It's a great honor to have with us one of the most distinguished scientists. He used to be with us, now he's with the University of Athens, but still with us within the framework of the research center. It's Professor Vallianatos, Filippos Vallianatos, that he has his bachelor degree with excellence in from the physics department from the Kapodistrian National University of Athens, a master degree in solid state physics from the same institution. That for the people that they are on abroad, this is our, let's say, MIT. A PhD degree in physics with excellence from the University of Athens. He was a postdoc in University of Uppsala in Sweden. In 1998, if I am correct, he joined the, as an assistant professor, the Technological Education Institute of Crete, the precursor of the Hellenic Mediterranean University. And since then, he has been visiting professor, lecturer in Brunel University, University of Basilicata in Italy, a Marie Curie Fellowship in University College London, a visiting lecturer in the University of Crete. Let me also accept, you know, people. He's also, since 2015, holder of the UNESCO chair in solid earth physics and geohazard. And since 2019, he's a full professor in geophysics and applied geophysics in the Department of Geology in the Kapodistrian National University of Athens. His work has received more than 5,000 citations, and his specialization is, among others, into geophysics, earth physics, seismology, and applied geophysics. Filippos, it's a great honor, as I mentioned. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Kostas, for your kind invitation, your kind words, and be sure that if even my body is in Athens, my soul is always in Crete with you. Today we will present some of the results of the effort that we have in a new scientific field called non-extensive statistical mechanics, and how this new scientific field applied in the understanding of earth physics. So as you can see on the title, we will try to merge somehow the ideas of statistical mechanics for that used for complex systems and how we can apply this to understand the basic properties and the fundamental rules that control the geodynamic processes over this planet and sometimes in other planets. So our approach is to understand with complexity theory a complex world. So, Kostas, I cannot go to the next slide. Sam.
I cannot control the presentation from here. It's like in your computer.
Just a moment. Okay. So, if you have no objections, can we use this one? Because maybe there is a problem with the way that we move the PowerPoint.
There are two options. You have the Zoom and you have full screen. You have to see in the full screen, not in the Zoom.
Just a moment.
Right now, to the next slide.
Let's to see if, okay, it's working.
Okay.
So, this presentation is organized in the following steps. So in the beginning, we will have an introduction and a very, fast historical background focused on the principles that of statistical mechanics, especially on non-extensive statistical mechanics. Our approach is scaling up approach. So we'll start to present our results from the laboratory scale, that means fractures, microcracks, and then we will upscale to the earthquake faults and even more. So the following chapters, let's say, will be presented. First, we will study the laboratory seismology and fracture, and we will see the experimental evidence of the applicability of non-extensive statistical physics on laboratory scale. After then, we will go to the fault, to the behavior of fault population distributions, and we will see how we can explain the laws observed using the ideas of non-extensive statistical physics. After then, we will scaling up more, we will study the seismicity in terms of statistical physics. We will try to see how the ideas of Charles entropy could be used to the understanding of earthquake size distribution and the spatial and temporal distribution of seismicity. Then, much more scaling up to planetary scale, we will see how the seismicity before the events of Sumatra and Japan change and how we interpret this change in planetary scale. And we will put down the questions on plate tectonics and geomagnetic reversals and if they will present some kind of behavior based on non-extensive statistical mechanics. And finally, we will see the behavior of seismic wave field as presented in Earth's ambient noise and coda waves. So all these points will try to present, to be presented in this talk. So let's go back to the title. On the title, we will see words like complexity, statistical mechanics, multi-scale dynamics, and earthquake fault systems. And let's to see what we include in each of these terms. Statistical mechanics, as is well common, is the science that tries to interpret systems that are composed of large number of simple interacting elements. And in our case, we are interested on non-random behavior. That we will try to understand is how we can use the observables, that means the expectations values some geophysical experiments using methods of statistical mechanics. Then we will discuss, we will see the multi-scale dynamics of the system. And in our case, the system includes a huge range of scales. We will try to see the phenomenology of dynamics, and then we will try to apply all this in earthquake fault systems. Our system is a really system of systems. It's composed in spatial scale from some kilometers distances over to some thousands of kilometers. And all these scales has to be interpreted in a unique way, starting from the basic principles of physics. In this, let's say, figure, you will see how all these scales expanded in time and distances. So in the laboratory scale, we have times which is less than a second, some milliseconds, and scales that are related with the scale of the crack, that means of the order of maybe millimeter, maybe less. And on the other edge of this, on the other corner of this figure, we can see scales that are related with some million years in time and distances that are some hundred or thousand of kilometers. So in the geodynamic scale, we have plate tectonics, we have convention that the time scale and spatial scale is completely different than the scale that we faced on laboratory experiments. And our job is to interpret this, let's to say, two groups of scales with the same unified way. That is the reason that all the methods that we used start from fracture and scaling up to the geodynamic scale. So there you can see experimental observations that we have from the creation of microcracks over a loading sample, and then we try to see if the laws that observed could be applied to large-scale effects observed in a planetary scale. And the idea that we present all these years, the last maybe more than 10 years, the last decade, is to understand the solid earth physics combining rock physics, seismology, and statistical physics with a unique way, transferring ideas from one field to the other and merging all these fields to in the interpretation of the geodynamic effects. So let's to see what's the problem that we will face, what's the basic questions that we will try to reply. We know that the physics of fracture could be a unique field in our interpretation. So we have a lot of theories that they present the opening of a fracture. But the answer, that the question that we will face is what are the collective properties of fractures? So our approach is to understand the collective properties of cracks and the collective properties of earthquakes. And we have to derive the properties of this pattern, the properties of this collection from first principles. So we wonder how can the collective properties of a set formed by all fractures or earthquakes in a given sample or region could be derived? How does the pattern formed by all fractures of earthquakes depend on its elementary entities used in this collection? And what are these properties? And as Leonid Kapitsa, a Nobel awarded scientist, says, pattern, the recognition of pattern is the core question in science. So the questions that we face all over these years are, what are the collective properties of the seismicity and fracture set defined by all earthquakes fracture in a given region? How does seismicity and fracture networks, which is the structure formed by all earthquakes or cracks, depends on elementary entities? And what are the properties of this dependence? What kind of dynamic processes control seismicity and fractures? And how are laboratory observations of fracturing and creep related with the geodynamic deformation? And what are the combining phenomena? And this is important if we would like to understand any precursory activity. The accompanying phenomena could be understood in laboratory scale and after that will be interpreted in geodynamic scale. So let's to see what is the method selected to face and all these questions. It is natural to consider that the physics of many earthquakes or fractures has to be studied with a different approach than the physics of one. And in this sense, since we have to face a collective property, we can consider that the use of statistical physics is not only the appropriate, but also the necessary tool to understand the collective properties of earthquakes or fractures. So if we will design that the statistical physics is the methodological tool in our approach, then the natural question arises, what type of statistical physics is appropriate to be used to describe effects from the micro scale and crack opening level to the level of large mega earthquakes and plate tectonics? So our answer was that to select non-extensive statistical physics that originally introduced by Challis. The latter statistical physics is the, in our view, the appropriate methodological tool to describe entities that they present multifractal distributions of their elements and we have long-range interactions or strong memory effects. Fracture phenomena and earthquakes belong to this category of effects. We justify that non-extensive statistical physics is the appropriate tool that we have to use in our approach. And the cornerstone in our approach, as we know all from our physics in the university, are two entities, energy and entropy. Energy concerns the possibilities. Entropy concerns the probability of those possibilities. And these fundamental principles has to be used in order to understand the fundamental properties of fracture and seismicity. So, going back to our elementary thermodynamics on the second university year, we know all the Boltzmann-Gibbs entropy. So, the evolution of the enological framework was from Boltzmann to Gibbs, and the revolution was offered by Konstantinos Tsalis, a physicist working in Brazil, born in Athens, and grew up in Argentina when his family moved in the early 50s after the Greek Civil War. So Konstantinos was proposed a change, a revolution in our definition for the entropy, and I'm very, very lucky person because I have met this significant person and I host him when I was in Crete for a week in the Technological Educational Institute of Crete, maybe a few years ago. So the Tsalis entropy is successful in describing systems with long-range interaction, multifractal space-time constraints, or long-term memory. Its definition is given by this expression, where we have the probabilities and the parameter Q, which is the cornerstone of this new theory. The parameter Q is the parameter that controls the degree of complexity of the system. So, as far as this parameter from the value one, as more complex is the system that we would like to describe. And all this theory was proposed and in a seminal paper by Konstantinos Tsalis on general statistical physics, maybe 3 decades ago. And this theory has applied in a lot, in many ranges of science, like to understand turbulence, high energy collisions, cosmic rays. A new scientific field was created, like econophysics, which is a combination of physics and economy, to study extreme events in economy, biological systems, and in natural hazards, with the first paper published maybe 10 years ago. So, the basic property of Boltzmann-Gibbs entropy, among others, is additivity. So, if we have a system, two independent systems, A and B, then the entropy of the merging system A plus B should be the summation of entropies of each system. But this additivity property is violated in complex systems and is the core property of the new Tsalis entropy. So if we have two independent systems, A and B, so the entropy of A plus B is given by the entropy of A plus the entropy of B, plus a third term, which is express the interaction and the hierarchical structure of the system. And this additional term is zero if Q is equal to one, and then it's not a complex system if Q is one, but it's just a system with short rate interactions and no memory, a random system that could be described by Boltzmann-Gibbs. If Q is greater than one, then the entropy of the total system is less than the entropy of the initial systems, and we have subadditivity. And in the case where Q is less than one, we have superadditivity. So, skipping all the mathematics that are behind all this theory, let's to optimize Tsalis entropy. If we optimize Tsalis entropy using the classical methods of Lagrange multipliers and all the methods of elementary statistical physics, then we can we lead to the probability distributions. In our case, the a parameter X that we use should be any observation or any observable that is related with seismological or the geodynamic quantities like the seismic moment, the derivative time distribution, the derivative time, that means the time between events, fractures or earthquakes, or the derivative distance, that means the distance between two sequential earthquakes or cracks. So, under the proper normalized normalization conditions and using the generalized expectation values defined by Challis, we lead to the probability distributions. Just I would like to draw your attention that there we have a generalization of the exponential function that we call Q exponential. It's given by this expression, and this is the most important function if we are dealing with the application of non-extensive statistical physics in earth sciences. So, the cumulative distribution function could be estimated by Q exponential, and this is very important because in earth sciences, the cumulative distribution function is the function that traditionally used in order to describe geodynamic and geophysical phenomena. So, the properties are, if Q is greater than one, then the Q exponential is behaves asymptotically as a power law. Power law is a typical behavior of in a lot of geophysical effects. And if Q is between zero and one, we have cutoff effects that usually appears in a seismicity, which is located in a region. There you can see the graphs. You can see that if Q is equal to one, we have the exponential. And if we will see these graphs in a log-log scale, we have power law for greater than one and cutoff if we Q is less than one. Another parameter usually applied in earth sciences is to see another method that applied is to see if the fluctuations observed in a quantity, in the square quantity, behave Gaussian or not. Using Challis entropy for a system with long range interactions and memory and multifractality, the theory introduced a generalization which is called Q-Gaussian. And this is given by this expression. And if Q is approaching one, then the generalized Gaussian recovers the normal Gaussian distribution. There you can see how it looks like. With Q equal to one, there the arrow, with the blue arrow indicates the Q equal to one. We have the Gaussian in a log log scale. And if Q is greater than one, we have that we call fat tails. This is very important because the probabilities expected using the normal Gaussian is order of magnitudes less for the probabilities expected for Q Gaussian. And this could be explained via the frequent appearance of extreme events. So let's go now to the applications, and we will go a little bit fast since we spend a lot of time in this new theoretical tools. There you can see experimental evidence, the experiment that supports the non-extensive statistical mechanics in laboratory scale. We use triaxially deformed basalts from Earth, Etna, we record acoustic emissions, and we try to see how is the behavior of the acoustic emissions, the parameters that observed for acoustic emissions. The parameters are the microcrack seismic moment, the derivative time, and the derivative distances. And there you can see some records of, and the dark dots are the acoustic emissions observed versus time. And there are the distributions. We have the cumulative distribution function of the seismic moment for the acoustic emissions. There you can see values of the order of 10 to minus 10, maybe 10 orders of magnitude less than the earthquakes, since are the opening of microcracks in the lab. You will see that we have a very good power law and a Q parameter of the order of 1.8. And we proceed now with the inter-event time distributions of microcracks that you will see there. T is the inter-event time in microcracks. You will see that we have a very beautiful fitting with Q exponentials and the Q parameter of the order of 1.3 and the inter-event distances and a Q parameter of the order of 0.66. So we have a triplet, we introduce a triplet, three Q parameters for the seismic moment, the inter-event time, and the inter-event distance that they present the system. All these are presented on the paper which describes the first experimental observation of non-extensive statistical physics in fracturing published 8 years ago. And all these theories in laboratory scale reviewed in a chapter by Saldas, Vallianatos, Triadis, and Stavrakas in the book on complexity of seismic time series published 2 years ago. The same approach is when we try to interpret pressure-stimulated currents, and you will see the experiment. We have the pressure-stimulated currents versus time, and the behavior is again by a Q exponential. You will see this in the power law observed when we stress this material from amphibolite and another material from MARB, and you will see the behavior which is control, which is power law behavior. We interpret these ideas using what we call superstatistical approach. The ideas hidden in this approach is that we have subdomains that are relaxed using a Debye approximation, and then all this combination of Debye approximation with a relaxation time, which is not constant, but changed from the subdomain to subdomain used, we have the superposition of this all this relaxation time. And this superposition of this relaxation time, assuming that they follow a chi-square distribution, justifies the Q-exponential behavior. So the idea is that each subdomain is controlled by exponential decay, but the macroscopic observation, which is just the superposition of all microscopic observations, is controlled by the collective properties of each of them and could be justified using this approximation, could be justified the appearance of a Q exponential function. Let's scaling up from the laboratory scale to the fault systems. We know that we have power law scaling in the left distributions, and let's to see if our new approach could be justified, the scaling observed. We start from Crete. We start analyzing the fault lens in the central Crete graben. We saw that they follow a power law, as we can see on this figure there. And this power law corresponds to a Q parameter of the order 1.16. The same was in an application of faults in Valle Marineris in Mars. We have segments of independent faults and segments of strongly directed faults. So analyzing the faults offered to us by planetary geologists, we saw that the independent faults give a Q value of 1.1, very close to one, that is the Boltzmann statistics, the independent elements statistics, and the directed faults are giving a Q value of 1.75, indicating the structure interaction of faults. The same was with analyzing about 25,000 faults from a mission on Mars on the satellite project that is called MOLA, and analyzing the compressional and extensional faults, we've justified for first time for a body out of the Earth that we have a Q exponential statistics with parameters that are of the order of 1.2, 1.3 for compression and extension of force, respectively. And back to the very close to us, to the core of Gulf of Corinth, we have the same observations of such statistics. These observations could justify the growing of faults. So increasing strain, we can see that we have in the beginning of some million of years of the evolution of faults, we have exponential the statistics. After that, the faults organized with hierarchy, with rules, and then we have an asymptotic power law that describes the interactions and the hierarchy. And then when we have leakage of faults and growing, and the faults are getting, the fault systems are getting old, fail again to the exponential scaling. All this introduce a new science, the science of non-extensive statistical seismology. And this science of non-extensive statistical seismology, if applied to the fragment areas of a fault and using the Challis entropy, could give a new law for the distribution of magnitudes of earthquakes, which is a generalization of the well-known Gutenberg-Richter law, which is used in everyday practice of seismologists. There is the expression of the old law just on the line on the bottom of this transparency, and B is the characteristic value where some thousands of papers have analyzed, and this B value is connected with a new Q parameter of this new statistical physics approach. We apply all this theory in the Hellenic arc. We found the distribution of the Q parameter, which is corresponds to the Q, which is related with the magnitude distribution for the Hellenic arc. We saw how this changed from the Ionian Islands to the Hellenic, to the south of Crete, to the front of the Hellenic arc. We try to apply this distribution and how, and to see if Q changes before big events. We have strong evidence that this Q parameter change, we observe this change of parameters for the Kobe earthquake in Japan and for the Crete earthquake a few years ago. And then let's to see how the special temporal description of seismicity could be interpreted in terms of Q exponential distributions. The first paper applied was on the aftershock sequence on Aegio 95 earthquake. We saw that the event times follow very good Q exponential with a value of close to 1.6. And then we apply this in the frame of the PhD of George Papadakis, one of my students in UCL time, for the Hellenic arc. We saw that we have very, very strong interaction for the derivative times in the front of the Hellenic arc, and we estimate the Q parameter for the derivative times and the derivative and the Q parameter for the derivative distances along the Hellenic arc. And we expand even more the theory, generalized the even using much more generalized functions as the functions given in this expression. It's not just expressions offered by a magic way, but are expressions that not only fit the data, as you can see there for the Hellenic territory and the Corinth Rift, but are expressions that are could be interpreted using stochastic equations, as the question presented there, which is controls the evolution of the derivative time t versus the time. So these stochastic equations could be consist of two terms, one term which is deterministic and another term with a W, which is the Wiener process, which is a standard Wiener process, and these stochastic equations correspond to a Fokker plan that, if we will solve analytically, give all these generalized expressions. All the details, the mathematical details, which is much more complex, are presented in a paper in Physical Review A by Michas and myself, and gives an excellent fitting of the California seismicity, as you can see there, along with a global one. So we will go a little bit fast because the time is limited. And we analyze even cases that we have two power laws, and these cases observed for the strong planetary events as the Sumatra and Japan events. There you can see the distribution of seismic moment, and you will see how these tails of distribution change. So we have a parameter Q, which is describes the main part of the distribution, and another parameter that describes the tails of this distribution. This is called R parameter. And you can see that even if this Q parameter is constant, we have the tails of this parameter that controls the strong events changing in planetary scale before the Sumatra mega event, and changing planetary scale before the Japan event, that maybe indicates that these mega events control the seismicity in, all over the planet. Another application of our theory is that to study the increments of earthquake energies. So there we study the increments, the normalized increments, and you can see that the increments of normalized increments deviate from the Gaussian. So we have that we call fat tails, that these fat tails are appropriate, describe that we call the strong events. There you can see the distribution, the world seismicity distribution. The previous one was the seismicity distribution for the Santorini volcanic complex during 2011-2012, when we have the unrest of Santorini volcano. And we apply also in the volcanic seismicity in Iceland. This is not published up to now. And we can see that the distribution does not change significant, but we have a significant change of the event time distribution in the pro-eruption phase and during the eruption phase. And then we face global scale tectonics, and we face fundamental questions. Is plate tectonics and the geomagnetic reversals just the results of non-extensivity? We analyzed the areas of plate of 50 plates that compose the our planet. We see that are not random, and you will see a very beautiful power law region. So we can see that the middle scale plates follow a fractal or a acute extensivity distribution, while the big tectonic plates observe an exponential roll-off. The same is for the polarity reversals of geomagnetic field. We studied the event time in million years between the reversals of the geomagnetic field. We found a very beautiful Q exponential distribution with Q 1.5. And the last application was on the seismic wave field. The seismic wave field, as up to now, has tested in the Earth's ambient noise and the seismic contact waves. Earth ambient noise is the normal Earth fluctuations that we observe anytime, 24 hours per day in our planet. Seismic contact waves are the waves that are the tails of the seismic recording after an earthquake. Ambient noise is just for the roots are not only anthropogenic, but also winds, the ocean tides, and a lot of such effects. The origin of seismic waves is the scattering of seismic waves, the multiple scattering of seismic waves from the inhomogeneities into the Earth. As you can see, the Earth's ambient noise and ambient noise is not noise, is not Gaussian, follows some fluctuations that could be interpreted in terms of two Gaussian distributions, as you can see, where the red curve is the two Gaussian with Q1.3, and the black one is the normal Gaussian. Just for fun, we test during a Medicane propagation, the Zorba Medicane years ago, the induced ambient seismic signals in different seismic stations. And we saw that when we have this Medicane, Mediterranean anomaly, meteorological anomaly, as this Medicane passed from the seismological station, we have increasing of ambient noise, and we observe that this ambient noise follows exactly the Q Gaussian distribution, and we observe that stations that are over the Medicane, like the station in the seismological station in Kalamata, presents much more complexity characteristics with a Q1.65 than, for example, the Chania station, which the Q is much lower. So it was the first effort to combine extreme events in meteorology, like the Medicanes, and to see their signature in seismological instrumentation, seismological networks. And then we studied the seismic Kodak waves from some particular events, strong events in the front of the Hellenic arc. And we have clear evidence that these Kodak waves, these tails of the seismic recording produced by the multi-scattering of seismic during the propagation of seismic waves in Earth's heterogeneities, follows a Q exponential, a Q Gaussian distribution far away from the normal Gaussian, and maybe the origin of this distribution is the complexity of distribution of the inhomogeneities. So our next step, because this research is on the way, is to try to extract the distribution of the scatterers, that means the inhomogeneities, in the Earth's interior using the information from the non-Gaussian characteristics of Kodak waves. And as you know, this church is nearby in some of you, near to the building of the Mediterranean University in Chania. So we study the church bell tower behavior in ambient noise. It's absolutely far away from Gaussian, and maybe this is indicated in the with the structural heart of the monument. So last but not least, we apply all this theory to the Arctic sea ice time series, where Arctic Ocean is an open, non-equilibrium, multi-component geophysical system with hierarchical properties and scaling behavior. This is just published maybe 1.5 months ago. And we study the stress field recorded on the ice in Arctic areas, the fluctuations of the stress field. The behavior is far away to be Gaussian, and this has to be taken seriously in consideration, because the probability distributions that we give for the stress fluctuation, which is related with the climate change, is much orders of magnitude lower than that expected from the observation and the Q Gaussian characteristic of this stress fluctuation on Arctic ice. So all this travel is on the way. We try to apply holistic approach to understand the physics, the Earth physics, and to interpret these Earth physics laws in terms of complexity and non-extensive statistical physics. We try to understand all the laws of Earth using some universal approaches. So this trial is on the way. A lot of this work has published in a book on complexity of seismic time series by Celis and myself and Luciano. And for the persons, for the colleagues that they have strange ideas, when is a good reading, what will be back on the beach of Crete. Last, I would like to present very fast some new initiative, which is a CVS PhD network on solid earth system dynamics. That will be from this will be offered from the in the frame of the European University CVS, and on the it is coordinated by the University of Athens with the participation of Bucharest, La Sapienza in Rome, Stockholm, and Brussels. And the enrollment of PhD students with supervision will start next September in a lot of fields that will cover the solid earth system dynamics, included rock mechanics, geodynamics, and geophysics. And with this, I would like to thank you for your kind attention, and I would like to apologize that I will spend much more time than I was expected by my good friend Kostas. Thank you very much for your presence here.
Thank you very much, Filippos, for the nice presentation. First of all, do we have any questions from the audience? You can switch on your cameras now. Any questions? Since I have Filippos, I have to say that I felt a little bit bad because you mentioned fundamental statistics, fundamental from the second year of it. So I think that I should go back to the desk in order to study again these wonderful things that you have presented. I would like to ask you a few questions, and I'm very sorry if my questions will be naive and from ignorance or fundamentals, I would say. You mentioned something about your techniques about that you exploit the memory effect. Am I right?
Yes.
And I have linked memory effects with ferroelectricity. I mean, mm-hmm. And your whole techniques were based on the acoustic waves. Am I right?
Yes. So in the scale, in the laboratory scale, yes, it's based on acoustic emissions.
Okay. So.
And we're working with a very good friend and colleague of you and me, Vasilis Aldas, on this topic.
Ah, all right. Yeah, this is very glad. And we are very fortunate that we have such a colleague within the university. I would like to ask you, so this and where is the memory effect within the acoustic waves, and how can you extend this approach from the lab to the large scale in order to be able to predict, for example, earthquakes and stuff like this?
So the system, yeah, yeah. The fundamental property, first of all, I would like to apologize because I put a lot of things in a very short time. That was not good for the understanding of a lot of things. The idea is that when we have the creation of a crack and acoustic emission, this creation of each crack forces the system in a reorganization of the scales observed. So each crack interact with the neighbor cracks already exist and reorganize the creation of the next one. So it's a process, it's an evolutionary process that the birth of each element, even if this is fracture, crack, or earthquake, reorganize local and even much more far from the point of the organization from the point of the birth of the crack, reorganize the stress field, local and in a longer scale. And all this change the evolution of the system. This is the root of the memory.
Mm-hmm. So it's and, like, Filippos, I'm sorry for the interruption. It's like to have a symphony. Then we have a source and this sound wave interaction interferes with other.
It's not the symphony. It's just a local disorder that controls the evolution in all the neighbor and far from the neighbor of, yes, the, of the system.
Yes.
And so the disorder is not local disorder. Each disorder is not independent from the other ones, but change the local equilibrium, and this non-equilibrium state has to be moved to another stage.
Mm-hmm.
And so these problems are problems that if we like to face, we need to combine statistical physics, non-equilibrium physics, crack mechanics, rock physics, geophysics and seismology. Is a real multidisciplinary science.
Yes, definitely. And let me, in order to help me to confuse, so this means that you have the creation of a new crack, and the way that we are going to detect this creation is going to be affected by already existing cracks. Am I right?
Exactly. Exactly. The past controls the future.
Yes.
And this control is not short term. It's not only the next event, but it's long term control. Yeah. So the memory of the system means that the future evolution of the system is controlled by the past stages that the system faces.
Mm-hmm. So in other words, the system has a collective behavior.
Not only collective behavior, but collective hierarchically and low-grade behavior. The collective should be just only one of the parameters that control the evolution of the system.
And Filippo,
as far as I know, some people, they try also to apply this in laser physics, maybe 6 or 7 years ago. In UCL, by the way, it was the nearby office when I was there.
So what did they try to do with physics, with laser physics?
I think that they tried to study some coherence waves and how they interact with the matter. I don't remember exactly the details. I read this paper maybe 6 or 7 years ago. I know that they had applied all this.
Yes, it would be nice if you can send it to me or to any people that are
on. I will try to find.
Thank you. And Filippos, I would like another question. Thank you very much. I suspect that this acoustic research that you have explained to me right now, very simple, are confirmed using also electrical measurements in order to also link these memory effects. Am I right?
Yes, with my colleague and your colleague Vasilis, we have a lot of work to present on this field, because acoustic emissions are due to microcracks. Microcracks are change the electrical properties of the material, and the evolution of crack change. Create, let's to say, a motion in the electrical carriers already presented due to defects in the solid. So all these carriers that we called the charged dislocations create some currents that is possible to be interpreted as precursors, not only to failure, but precursors also to earthquake. This is going back maybe in 25 years ago. It was the moving charge dislocation model was introduced maybe 25 years ago to interpret the behavior of electrical signals before earthquakes. Okay. By myself and some other colleagues.
Filippo, so it seems to me that you have this acoustic detection, you have, because of the cracks, you have some derivatives of pressure, and this pressure, they generated a piezoelectric effect within.
It's not piezoelectric. We observe this in materials that they have not even a lattice of piezoelectric material. It's a material which is controlled by dislocations. In all the materials, we have dislocations, and this dislocation from ideas of solid state physics from defects that are charged in an ionic soil are charged dislocations. So the opening of a dislocation because the opening of dislocation is just a moving of the charge that are on the faces of dislocation, and this motion of charge dislocation is equivalent to a current density. Imagine that we have some millions of cracks over there and into an earthquake focus. And all these huge number of moving charts create an observable current that sometimes we observe in the on the field, and most of the times we observe in the lab.
Okay, thank you. I will try to process it a little bit later on. And a last question regarding your European university.
Yeah.
This joint PhD degree, I mean, the PhD students are registered in the University of Athens or are considered as a PhD students within the whole consortium?
So yeah. Up to now, we have to solve a lot of legal problems that are related with it. And this is just for your efforts as European University. So each country has different legal rules for the enrollment of PhD. Mm-hmm. So we start with enrollment using what we call common supervision. We enroll this student in each of the participating university according to the student's choice, and we have common supervision among the different participating universities. That's the simplest way in order to secure that we are legal in all over the participating universities, and to offer to the student an environment that is, as you can see, we have some audience there, my dog, and to offer to the student the secure environment for a mobility.
So you offer a topic. The student selects to which university he will be registered, and then supervised by the rest committee, and he can move to do experiments like
Because this is, as you know, this initiative is strongly supported by Erasmus Mobility.
Yes.
So we have funds for Erasmus Mobility, but the problem is that, for example, in Italy, the PhD students, they have salary. In Greece, not. It's not accepted PhD student in Italy if there is no salary.
All right.
So we have to face the rules between Greece, Italy, Sweden, and Brussels, let's say. And up to now, we moved with a safe way. We have common supervision and mobility.
Okay, this is very clear.
Try to avoid to be involved if we try to use this in your European university with a legal mess that exists in different countries.
This can be done. I think it's very clear how you can do it on the PhD level. But if you move downwards, like to postgraduate degrees and undergraduate degrees, then you need accreditation, and then it's a whole challenge. And
it's a mess.
Yes. Okay. So if, are there any questions? I'm sorry, I asked you before. If you have questions, no one had, so I had to ask. Any questions from the audience? Okay.
It's not a question, it's just a comment that what Filippos described in a micro scale, some of these things are valid also in our research, when we generate acoustic waves on materials using lasers, and then we see the propagation of the waves, either surface waves or bulk waves, to investigate the micro cracks in the material. And we actually see the reorganization of the material when there is a micro crack. The material will reorganize itself in order to find a new equilibrium.
I think, Michalis, the same research happens as very nice Filippos mentioned, and you have noticed right now, using ultrasounds in order to detect the micro cracks within mechanical systems like aircraft and etc.
Yes.
Very good.
If you have the full record of the system that you observe, it's a matter of a quarter to see with a software that we have developed to detect such things, to see if they present fat tails and to estimate the Q value.
So
it's up to you now.
Thank you, Filippos. Thank you, Michalis. Thank you, the rest of the people or from the audience. It's time to finish. I know that you have a meeting right now, so it's better to finish a little bit at now. Until next week, next Friday, we have a talk from a professor from the Technical University of Chania regarding smart cities, Professor Kolokotsa. So I hope to have all of you together with us next Friday. So take care and be safe, and bye-bye.
Thank you very much, Kostas. Thank you very much for your presence here. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Take care. Thank you very much. Bye.